So our students, we're starting with the chapter here, that is the making of a scientist. Is it visible, the screen? Yes. Okay, fine. And we have still students who are joining. Right. Now we had done the previous chapter, that was Footprints Without Feet. That was also about a scientist. Yes, but at the end of the chapter, what did we think about that scientist? What did we think about Griffin? We don't think, ma'am.
He's a bad person.
That he is a bad person. Okay, very nice. Very good. That he was a good scientist, but he was not a good human being. Right? And yes, so do we want such a scientist in society? No, we don't want such a scientist in society. We want a scientist who will contribute in a positive way, who will make our society better, safer, right? And yeah, so it could be just imagine like you've learned about computers and a big computer expert, but you use your expertise for hacking and maybe for bullying and stalking and all that stuff, right? That is not good. Like we're reading so much about online, you know, crimes and things like that here. So if someone is there using his expertise in a wrong manner, then we do not really appreciate that person. Similarly, scientists also, right? So if they have certain qualities and whatever discoveries they have done, if they are doing that for the betterment of society, they are worth appreciating. They deserve all the awards and recognition, right? So when we talk about our president of India, former, talk about Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, right? And with always with respect. So other scientists also whom we are aware of. Now here in this chapter, what we are going to read about, it's about the scientist. And once again, do you think a person has to be born a genius to become a scientist? So when you talk about Albert Einstein, till now, yes, we think, you know, the intelligence of that person is not matched. No one as intelligent as him, right? But nowadays people are coming up with these reports, you know, someone with more, yeah, with more IQ than that of Einstein and all that. Right. So when you talk about Newton, we talk about Archimedes and all, they did not have so much of facilities also. But even then, they were committed. They found out, you know, so much about science. They gave us so many theories. Right. So what do you think? Is it genius, which is an important aspect which determines whether you can become a scientist, or is it our dedication and commitment? Yes, dedication and commitment. So you might not necessarily be a genius, but if you are hardworking and you want to, you know, like pursue that, it will make you realize your dream. Now, this is a story about the making of a scientist. There is no fixed formula that you take so much of this and that and all. It's not a chemical reaction that you put together and, oh, wow, what is the product? The scientist. No. It's not like that. Otherwise, we'll have all reactions for, okay, we want an engineer. Let's put this together. Engineer is ready. We want a doctor. Let's put all these qualities. No. So it is very, very, like, of course, we are all here in the same classroom. I am teaching all the same 48 students. But many of you are like, of course, might end up becoming engineers or doctors. Others might go on to pursue other things. Right? So it is not necessarily here. It's not only the conditions that you get in school, but it is also the conditions that you get at home. Right? Like, of course, the person whose father is a doctor, he goes back home and, you know, he listens to his father talking about patients and the symptoms, and maybe they have a clinic at home and he sees the patients coming and going and the father, parents discussing all that. He's going to learn so much. Right? Just by observing, just by listening. So these things are also there. So our environment at home also determines a lot the way we are shaped, right? How we are molded and how we carry on with our achievements. Now, when you talk about Ebright, you talk about the scientist here. And let us read about it. How was it that he became a scientist? He was not an extraordinary genius. He was someone as ordinary as us. And just a minute, let me put this right. Okay. How did a book become a turning point in Richard Ebright's life? So he was, like he had this book, his mother gave him a book, and that book, it ended up, you know, making him a scientist. How would a book change his life? And how did his mother help him? As I said, our environment at home, our family conditions really determine, our future. They really determine the options that we are going to take, or the future course that we are going to decide now. Yes, so here let us read about Richard Ebright. At the age of 22, a former scout of the year excited the scientific world with a new theory on how cells work. There's so much you read in your science class. Right, you read about cells, you read about cell division, you read about, what physiological phenomena and all, you talk about respiration and digestion, so many things you read about. And we're very surprised at how do we get all this information? How did the scientists gather all this information? Right, so that it is here right in front of us in the textbook. Right, so it is there. It is not an easy job. It is quite a lot of hard work. Now, so he excited, 22-year-old scientist, exciting the world with a new theory on how cells work. Richard H. Ebright and a college roommate explained the theory in an article in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Science. So in a very reputed journal, so it was Richard Ebright and his friend. So they had this report, or they had an article there in this journal talking about their discovery, right? It was the first time this important scientific journal had ever published the work of college students. The college students, imagine 22, 23-year-old students, their work being published in such a reputed journal. How important their work must be that it got published. Yes? Want to say something? No. So that means otherwise, this journal, it was only the scientists who had spent so many years in research and so many years of hard work that their articles were published. In sports, that would be like making the big leagues at the age of 15, like you're in the national team at the age of 15, which is something very, very remarkable. If you talk about the world of sports, we talk about cricket and others here. So you're selected at the age of 15. Wow, what a remarkable achievement. You have so many experienced people and you are there among them. So it's like that. It's a similar kind of achievement. He's giving this kind of a comparison, parallel, okay? And hitting a home year in your first time at bat. And yeah, like, okay, you go out to, of course, they're talking about baseball and all. We can talk about cricket. We are more familiar with cricket than with baseball, isn't it? Right? So here, the debut play and you're getting a century. What a achievement, right? So this is what his achievement has been, yeah? Okay, yeah. For Richard Ebright, it was the first in a long string of achievements in science and other fields. And it all started with butterflies. How can anyone be interested in butterflies? Yes, so it is. People can be interested in butterflies. And oh my God, so much of, what a breeze coming in the classroom. Yeah, we're going to fly out now. There's a storm coming. Class, please behave. Please, silence. So butterflies, yes, we wonder that how could this child, you know, by studying butterflies, he became such a reputed scientist. What is there about butterflies to study? What do you know about the life of butterflies? Yes? About the nature, you want to study about the butterfly's nature? Yes? Structure of the butterfly, okay. What about the life cycle of what is it? What is it so peculiar about the life of the butterfly? Is it always so beautiful? Yes? Yeah, so like, of course, you have it goes into that pupa and like the cocoon is there and it emerges from there, the caterpillar, yeah. So all these stages are there in the life of the butterfly. And yes, do we like butterflies? Yes, why do we like them? Because they're so beautiful, they're so colorful. You love running after them, try to catch them. Have you ever tried catching a butterfly? Because we can't catch them, simple as that. Isn't it? It's so difficult to... Then? So, whenever you chase a butterfly, you go out catching. But yeah, it is there, you know, like you go to the garden and you see the butterflies from one flower to the other. It is beautiful. What do you get? Okay, your bees. Bees will come chasing after you. Don't worry, you don't have to chase them. They'll come after you, isn't it? Right? What? Yeah, that's what I say. They, right? And we stay away from bees because we know they are dangerous. Naturally, it is. Yeah, because the sting has it, the wasp and the bee. Right. Okay, now come on and let's read about the butterflies here. And you're going to find out one word for me tomorrow. That is, what do we call a person who studies about butterflies? A botanist? Zoologist? You are going to find out and let me know. And Bhavin is going to remind me. What do we call a person who studies butterflies, right? Or collects also. We have people collecting also, right? Okay, an only child, Ebright, grew up north of Reading, Pennsylvania. There wasn't much I could do there, he said. I certainly could not play football or baseball with a team of one, but there was one thing I could do, collect things. See, as I said, what happens in our childhood, how it affects what happens in our later years. So Ebright was an only child and he went with his mother to live in this place, Reading, Pennsylvania. And most of the time he was alone and he was in such a place where he did not have many friends. So if we have a lot of friends living nearby, it's so easy to spend the time. Right, you play with them and you study with them and they can come over to your place, you can go there and so it is no problem at all. But the mother here, she did not know what to do and how to keep him busy. So what did she involve him in? Collecting things. What are things that people generally collect? Stones, okay, people collecting stones. Stamps, very good. People collect stamps and coins. Very nice. What else?
Bottle caps.
Bottle caps. What? Current coins. Yeah, coins they collect. Yes. Cans. Maybe like some signature cans. And all. Not anyone. So maybe, right, you have some special editions there. Right, and so people are there. Yes, birthday cards, greeting cards. Then which cards? Different kinds of cards. Players, that wrestling cards and all you have. Yes. Okay. Right. But will you continue that hobby as you grow older?
Yes.
You still have it now?
Yes,
ma'am. Right. So here it is. We are talking about things. You know, like people, they have this habit and. If they have this collection, they want to add to it. Whenever they get the time, you know, they never give up that collection. So what did Ebright start doing? He started collecting things. Okay. Right. So he did, and did he ever? He started collecting things and he never stopped. Big exclamation. Beginning in kindergarten, Ebright collected butterflies with the same determination that has marked all his activities. In kindergarten, were you even aware I should collect something? Were you even aware in your kindergarten years about collecting anything at all? No, right? So look at him. Yes, so he started collecting. He also collected rocks. Your KG classes. Kindergarten, KG. Right? It's a German word. Now he also collected rocks, fossils, and coins. Imagine, like, look at him. Collecting, rocks, so different kinds of rocks, fossils, yes, so fossils there, right, yes, coins. He became an eager astronomer too, sometimes stargazing all at night. Stargazing means looking at the stars. And do you think it's something very nice to do? Is it something very beautiful?
Yes.
Yeah, looking at the stars, yes. And trying to identify the constellations, maybe, and right, how Venus, with the Venus, that planet, right? Yes. Yeah, looking for that. Maybe the different positions, the planetary positions, and how it changes things and all. Right, so people are, they're really into. You know, but one thing is there, whenever you want to do something, right? Why, like sometimes we do something for a couple of weeks, then we get bored, right? We're bored really easily because we're not determined enough, or maybe we're confused. That's why. But people are very determined. Look at this boy, he was alone. He did not have much to do and he started collecting things. And his mother also encouraged it, hobby. And see, as he's collecting things, how much knowledge he's gaining. If he's collecting rocks, he's getting information about rocks. He's able to identify them, right? Then, of course, whether it's about fossils also, it's about coins. Now, looking at the stars, astronomy is not easy, I think. It's not easy, right? So, yeah, looking at the stars and all night, he said. From the first, he had a driving curiosity along with a bright mind. So he was there. You need a bright mind to pursue that. He also had a mother who encouraged his interest in learning. Second condition. You need your parents to encourage you. You need that kind of environment at home also, who will, you know, allow you to continue with your passion. She took him on trips, bought him telescopes. Microscopes. What are telescopes used for? What do you use telescopes for? Stars. Microscopes. What do we use the microscope for? Yes, absolutely. See the tiny thing. Naked eye. Very good. You just finished it in science and you give me the definition. What about a magnifying glass? What do we use a magnifying glass for? Yeah, okay, thank you for that information. So yeah, a magnifying glass here, you can't see something clearly, or you have, you know, like, yeah, there's a semi-precious stone you want to look at clearly, or maybe a small coin you want to identify, a piece of rock you want to identify, right? Find, yeah, your detectives also, isn't it, right? They have the looking for footprints and fingerprints and all that, anything there, maybe a hair or a button which people have not seen, looking for that. So magnifying glass, it makes things look bigger, okay? So telescope, microscope, cameras, mounting materials for his slides and all, to look under the microscope. And other equipment, and helped him in many ways. So if you have all these equipment, do you think you're going to stop learning? You're never going to stop learning. You're going to have that curiosity. You have something or the other to do. You're never going to sit idle. You're going to not going to spend hours and hours in front of the camera, or rather this mobile phone. You'll have other things to do, isn't it? Better things to do, productive things to do, right? Yes. I was his only companion until he started school. Companion? Friend, right? So his mother was until he started school. And after that, I would bring home friends for him. So she would request, you know, his friends to come home and spend time with him. But at night, we just did things together. His friends couldn't be with him the whole time. Richie was my whole life after his father died, when Richie was in third grade. Right? So his mother kept him busy. And after his father died, so she was there devoting more and more time with him. Right? Letting him feel bored and not letting him give up. Okay? Yes. Okay. And learn he did. He earned top grades in school because he already knew so much more than the other children. He's already done a lot of hard work already. On everyday things, he was just like every other kid. But in everyday things, you know, whether it was sports maybe or painting and things like that, he was like any other ordinary kid. But when he came to learning and all, he was far, far ahead of them. By the time he was in the second grade, Ebright had collected all 25 species of butterflies found around his hometown. So he was in the second grade when he had this big collection of butterflies. Can you look at the names of these butterflies here? So we have a gossamer winged butterfly. We had wood nymphs and satyrs, brush-footed butterflies, right? Yeah. Okay, so just look at it. Look at it here. Look at all the butterflies there, right? Which he has collected, right? Before or rather by the time he was in second grade. Okay, so he's collected all this. That probably would have been the end of my butterfly collecting, he said. But then my mother got me a children's book called The Travels of Monarch X. That book, which told how monarch butterflies migrate to Central America, opened the world of science to the eager young collector. He said, I would have stopped collecting butterflies because he had collected most of the butterflies that were found in his neighborhood. But then his mother brought him a book, which was The Travels of Monarch X. Please remember the name of this book, because this was the book that changed the life of the scientist, which really, you can say, as it was, made him a scientist, or it was the making of a scientist. Clear? Till here, is everything fine? So where did Ebright live? Which place did Ebright live? Where did he live? Look at your book and tell me. Where did he shift to? Where did his mother shift? Where did Ebright live? Reading, Pennsylvania. Kahan hai ye? Look at the answer and tell me. So where did he live? Pennsylvania. Reading,